Can I show you the symbol first of all? Because that's kind of at the centre of it. And I'm going to draw the sort of the quick and dirty z equals, which looks like this. Okay. And it's kind of a bit like an equal sign, but it's zigzaggy. And the reason for that is it's sort of a approximation symbol, but it's more precise than that. And the zigzagginess and the Zs are supposed to make you kind of think of zeros, because this technique involves lots of zeros, especially for big calculations. Really, what we're doing is reducing every number to one significant figure. And let's start with a really simple calculation. You know, one of your basic times tables, like 3 times 7. Well, hopefully everyone knows that that's 21. But actually, if we say what it z equals, then we round it to the nearest round number with one digit followed by a zero. So 3 times 7 z equals 20. Okay, let's take another one. So 5 times 8 equals, bad example.
Let's do one below.
Let's do one below.
Right. Even I know what that is.
Yeah, that's right. Let's do 7 times 8, because no one can ever remember that. But I'll tell you what it equals. It equals 56. But it's equals 60, because you round it ruthlessly to one significant figure.
It's almost more work at the moment to do the zequeling than the equaling.
Yeah, I can see why you'd think that, but if we get onto a more complicated calculation, I think you'll begin to see why it's actually quite handy to just simplify everything at the first opportunity. Should we do a big one? 436 times 68, okay? Well, if we're zequeling this, the first thing we do is simplify these numbers. So that's z equals 400 times 70, okay? So we've simplified both those to make this calculation, because then it's just gonna be 4 times 7 and then add on all the zeros at the end. So that equals, well, 7 fours are 28 followed by 3 zeros, so it equals 28,000. But actually, we're being really ruthless because we just want a rough answer. It z equals 30,000. So 436 times 68 z equals 30,000. And you know what? That's pretty close to the right answer. We'll just check what the actual answer is. 29,648. Now in this case, that is really close. So z equals has been amazingly accurate. It's not always quite as accurate as that, but in fact, in most estimation challenges, you're really looking for something that's an order of magnitude, and z equals works in most situations.
Hi there, everyone. I'm going to interrupt my own video at this point because I can hear some of the number files screaming at the screen, upset by this ruthless rounding, this dismissing of digits. And I can kind of understand that. So I spoke to my graphing expert, Dave Wiley, told him about z equals, and he actually put this together. This is a graph showing where z equals is at its strongest and also where it's furthest from the true answer. I thought it might be worth a look, and I've put more details about it on my blog. I'll talk about this more at the end of this video, but let's get back to hearing more about what Rob has to say about z equals.
I think the most valuable thing here is it's giving you a feel for numbers, because, you know, there's a lot of obsession these days with people need to learn how to do long multiplication and so on. Well, we all use a calculator for anything difficult these days, and we don't need, most of us, most of the time, to do a really accurate calculation. A calculator can do that for us. But we do need to have a feel for numbers. And I suspect that many people who use calculators have no idea when the answer comes out whether that number is vaguely right or not. And the great power of z equals is it just allows you to very quickly work out roughly what the answer is. So you can say, well, look, is the number I've come up with, does it even make sense? Or has I've typed something wrong into this calculator or into my laptop or whatever? So what this is trying to generate more than anything else is a feel for numbers, and the power to be able to say, you know what, I don't know what exactly the answer is, but I do know roughly what the answer is.
Is this something people do intuitively anyway?
I think they do. I'm sure I have been estimating for years, and I think the difference here really between this and any old estimation is just how ruthlessly, you're simplifying things to one significant figure. So when we did the tables, you know, 7/8 of 56, 7/8 = 60, most people don't think to make the simplification at that point. So I'm just taking it one stage further to become a bit of a rounding extremist. You can be even more extreme than Z=, incidentally. You could round 60 and say, well, call it 100, it's close enough. But I'm just a little bit short of that extreme. I would say I'm not a sort of fifth decimal place kind of person. I really am a Z=y kind of person. As a degree, I actually did engineering, and there it's all about, you know, having a feel for numbers. There's a joke goes about how you can tell the difference between an engineer and a mathematician. So you ask them what pi is, and a mathematician will say, you know, it's 3.14, and it goes on forever, a transcendental number. Whereas an engineer will say, well, it's about 3, but let's call it 10 just to be on the safe side.
Is this the thin end of a wedge? I sometimes think that the emergence of text messaging and things like that has really eroded people's spelling ability. Mm. Would the emergence of Z=s in a kind of lazy, rounded estimation take away some of the real skill and craft that we want to engender in our future mathematicians?
I would say completely the opposite. If only your typical 14-year-old, frankly, even could just say off the top of the head what 7/8 is, that it's 56 in the first place, let alone be able to then round it to 60. So I think this skill is missing in so much of the population. Let's get them to this stage. And actually, strangely enough, I think the ability to estimate, even though it's all rough and ready, sometimes you actually need a lot of maths understanding to be able to do it in the first place. It probably has its most common application in financial stuff, working something out. You know, you're in a shop, you're working out a deal. And I mean, there's a question I've been asking teenagers, quite interesting to ask them. You say, right, I've got 70 people, each one a Mars bar, and let's say the Mars bar costs 80p and 70 people. So how much is that going to cost? And how much are we going to have to spend on that? And they kind of know it's 7/8, maybe they know 7/8 of 56, but they'll probably say £5.60, because that sounds like about what you'd spend on Mars bars. So being able to say, well, hang on a sec, you know, 70 times 80, it's like kind of 50 times 100. And what's that? Oh, 5,000, 50, okay. So it's sort of, does this answer make sense? I can give you an example of when Z=s would perhaps not be a good idea. For example, if you're taking your child's temperature and you like to use old-fashioned Fahrenheit for that and say, well, it's 98.4, let's Z=s that, let's call it 100. Well, suddenly you're thinking, well, maybe I should take him to the doctor then. Knowing when it's appropriate to round numbers and when not, is kind of, I've rather hidden that away in all of the Z=s stuff, that is a skill, a life skill, an experience skill. I hope they'll see the point. I hope they'll see that I'm not some, you know, ignorant person who's imposing some impurity on this great subject, but actually this is a handy tool. I'm going to guess quite a few of your viewers actually kind of do this with variations themselves, you know. So I'm just offering one technique where it's a shared language. We all play the same game. We round to one figure. But I'm not saying it's the best. I'm just saying it's one that's got a name now and a symbol.
Now, Rob's got a book out called More Maths for Mums and Dads, The Teenage Years, and it's in that book he talks about Z=s. Z=s is just a very small part of the book. It's full of all sorts of cool stuff, and I've put a link under this video if you want to check that out. Also, that graph I talked about that Dave put together where we've had a look at Z=s, you can find that on my blog. Again, links underneath. And if you want to see even more from this video, where I asked Rob even more questions, stuff that I've left out of this video for time reasons, I've put some of those extra questions and answers as an unlisted number file video, and there'll be links on the screen and underneath as well. So if you're really into this and you want to hear Rob talk about it more, because he's got a lot to say about it, go check that out.